that day, every soul is paid for what it earned, and none shall be unjustly treated. Lo, God is swift to reckon.
Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع نفوسنا أبي القاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه الغر الميامين الحمد لله الذي جعلنا من المتمسكين بولاية سيدي ومولاي علي بن أبي طالب الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله أما بعد يقول الله في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل لا أسألكم عليه أجرا إلا المودة في القربى The first of our salawat and honor of Rasulullah Muhammad صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم اللهم صل The second in honor of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib The third with your loudest voices, in honor of the Imam of our time, Imam Sahib al-Asri wa al-Zaman. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Respected scholars, brothers and sisters, salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Imam Ali ibn Muhammad al-Hadi, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. Was born in the year 214 after Hijrah and died in the year 254 after Hijrah at the age of 40. A man from whose life many a lesson may be learnt and many a principle may be derived. And indeed a man who is recognized for his extraordinary knowledge, bravery, passion and sacrifice. You find that when you examine Imam Ali ibn Muhammad al-Hadi, there are many lessons to learn about the political environment which faced the Imams of Ahlelbayt preceding the advent of the Mahdi from Al Muhammad, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. When we dissect his biography, we begin to realize the meaning of the words house arrest and why there was so much political pressure on the final of the Imams of the 12th of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt. Unfortunately, Imam Ali al-Hadi's life has not been studied in depth. His life has a historical base but a contemporary significance in that it was only a few years ago that we witnessed the bombings of his shrine and the shrine of his son Imam al-Askari salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi Allahumma salli ala You would think that many people would have been affected by the bombings of those shrines that many would have gone on to study his life to study his biography when they saw those shrines in Samarra bombed Unfortunately, that bombing did not have an effect on people except emotionally. There were many who were emotionally affected by Samarra, but not intellectually. If you were to ask many people when they heard that Samarra was bombed, did it affect them emotionally? Yes. Did it affect them to go and read a book on Imam al-Hadi and Imam al-Askari? Not really. There are many until today who do not know much about Imam al-Hadi and Imam al-Askari. Whereas what we do not realize is that the beginning of the political pressure on the Imams because of recognition of Imam al-Mahdi coming began with Imam al-Hadi. A As in, you have, for example, if you study the Zaydi text, Ar-Rad ala al-Rafida, by Al-Qasim ibn Ibrahim al-Rassi, who was a Zaydi living in the time of the 10th Imam. He was a Zaydi, and you know Zaydi stop at Imam Zayn al-Abidin. Then they continue with the line of Zayd. He would talk about the fact that Imam al-Hadi was seen as the 10th of the Imam of the Rafidah. In other words, people knew that Rasulullah had a hadith that there will be 12 Khalifas after me. All of them are from Quraysh. This person was mentioning that Al-Hadi was the 10th of the Imams of the Rafidah, which would indicate that the Abbasid Khulafa knew that the Mahdi is now about to be born. So when we study the life of Imam Al-Hadi, we are approaching that final part now where there's going to be major surveillance of the houses of the Imams of Ahlulbayt. Let's dissect his life and see what we can learn from it. As I said, Imam Al-Hadi was born in the 214th year after Hijrah. His mother was called Sumana Al-Maghribiyya. Maghrib, in today's language, is what? Morocco. In other words, his mother again was a lady from North Africa. How many Imams now do we have? There are a number of Imams now whose mothers are all from North Africa. You begin to notice that there isn't any movement of going back to ladies from Medina or a lady from Mecca. It is all ladies now from North African descent. And once again, the reasoning, what is it? On the first level, the reasoning is to remove any racism in Islam. Never should a Muslim community not allow their sons to get married to a lady who is from the followers of Ahlulbayt just because of her race. You look at our communities today, it seems that that went and was swept away from our communities. What the Imams tried to build was swept away. The Imams were marrying women, and that's why when even you read about Imam al-Hadi or Imam al-Jawad, it says that their skin was a bit darker than the Arab skin. Naturally, if they're marrying women from North Africa, then their sons aren't going to have the more light Arab complexion. It would have been a bit of a darker complexion that they had. And notice therefore that this Sumana from Al-Maghrib, the narration say, was one of the most pious women in Arabia. That this lady was a devout woman, a lady of the Quran, a lady of the narrations of the Prophet. Imam al-Jawad, as we know, was married to Umm al-Fadl, the daughter of al-Ma'mun. Umm al-Fadl did not give him any children. He married Sumana. Sumana gave him Imam al-Hadi. Imam al-Hadi, the beginning of his life, was more difficult than even Imam al-Jawad. Why? Imam al-Jawad was 8 years old when they tested him on his imamah. If Imam al-Hadi was born in the year 214, and Imam al-Jawad died in the year 220, so Imam al-Hadi was how old when he was announcing his imamah? 6. And that's why when we come to Imam Zaman, what are we going to see? When we come to Imam Zaman, we're going to notice that Imam Zaman is 5. Some people, when they hear Imam al-Zaman is 5, they say, how a 5-year-old? Well, we had just told you about a 6-year-old, and before that an 8-year-old. You notice that now begins a trend where you have Imams at a very young age. Imagine, Imam al-Jawad passes away, Imam al-Hadi is 6, Muntasir, Mu'tasim, the Caliph, now makes an announcement. What does Mu'tasim say? Mu'tasim calls his companion Umar ibn al-Faraj. He says, Umar, you know Al-Jawad was 8 when he became an Imam, do you remember? He said, yes. He said, do you believe his knowledge was truly from God? Or do you think maybe he had a private tuition when he was young, which affected his knowledge? You see, sometimes Allah can show you all the light, but you still don't believe. True. You can be shown all the light in the world, but you still don't believe. He said to him, do you think that it came from God, that knowledge about the ihram, the pilgrim who hunted, and what's the kafara? Is that from God? Umar ibn al-Faraj said, it doesn't matter. It might not be from God. It might be from a private tutor. He said, very well. Now that al-Jawad is dead, his son al-Hadi is 6. Maybe if we get to al-Hadi at this age, he will not have the knowledge Al-Jawad had. Subhanallah. You see where the mind is? 6, 8, these are all from the lines of Ahlulbayt. These are all people who inherit knowledge one from another. So do you know what they did? They got a private tutor called Ubaidullah al-Junaidi. Ubaidullah al-Junaidi was a master of law, master of Quran, master of hadith, master of ethics, master of Arabic grammar. He had mastered absolutely everything. He came to Al-Mu'tasim. Al-Mu'tasim looked at him. Al-Mu'tasim said to him, listen, you know that 6-year-old there? He said, which 6-year-old? He said, the one there. He said, oh, Ali, son of Muhammad? He said, yes. He said, we want you to be his tutor from now. So when Umar ibn al-Faraj then interrupted and said, you know why we want him as, why we want you as his tutor? He said, why? He said, we want you to get to his mind before another person gets to his mind. So he said to him, what do you want me to instill in his mind? He said, instill in him the hatred towards the religion of Islam. Ubaidullah al-Junaidi said, but I'm of the scholars of Islam. He said, okay, instill in him the hatred of this idea of family of the Prophet. Let him believe in something else. Ubaidullah al-Junaidi said, leave this to me. I'm a man of age. This is a 6-year-old. His father was 8, maybe he had a private tutor. 6 years old, leave it to me. Ubaidullah al-Junaidi went in. The next day someone saw him. Ubaidullah, how's your servant doing from Bani Hashim? He said, which servant? He said, you know, the kid, the 6-year-old, how's he doing? He said, don't call him a servant. This is one of the scholars of Al-Muhammad. I said to him, what do you mean? He said, when I entered upon the house, I said to the kid, I said to him, child, recite for me a surah from the Quran. So the child looked at me and said, you name the surah, I'll continue reciting. So as soon as I named the surah, I picked the longest surah in the Quran. This child began and continued reciting. And his voice was the equivalent of the voice of Prophet Dawood alayhi salam. His voice, I have never heard a voice like this. That when the Quran says Dawood's voice was amazing, I guarantee you his voice was like Dawood. And then he said, but do you know something more extraordinary, which tells me that these have got knowledge from God, not from a private tutor? He said to him, what is it? He said, every verse of the Quran I ask him about, he tells me when it was revealed, where it was revealed, and about who it was revealed. He said, can you tell me how a 6-year-old can know all of this already? He said, don't leave me with this child, because it's not me who's disciplining him, he's disciplining me. It's better that I walk away. When Al-Mu'tasim heard this, Al-Mu'tasim thought, yes, I know they have knowledge, but surely there is someone who could question them. Do you know who Al-Mu'tasim called again? Sometimes, wallah, you don't learn from your mistakes, do you? He called Yahya bin Akhtam again. Yahya bin Akhtam had already gone through the most embarrassing day of his life with Imam Al-Jawad. Now Yahya comes back again. Al-Mu'tasim says to him, Yahya, I want you to ask this young man questions. He said, you mean the one who's the son of the one I asked for, Mamun? He said, yes. He said, do we have to go through this again? He said, yes, Yahya, ask him. He said, but you know, these people, their knowledge is different. These people aren't chosen by man. There is someone else who chose them, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said to him, do not talk like that to me. Ask. I did not see what Al-Ma'mun saw. For all I know, it is not real. You know, sometimes people can tell you, you don't listen. So Yahya bin Akhtab looked at me and said, so we ask Ali al-Hadi? He said, yes, ask Ali al-Hadi. He came to Imam Ali al-Hadi, he said to him, Ali, I have some questions to ask you. Ali al-Hadi said, about what? He said, I have questions to ask you about Prophet Adam and about Prophet Sulaiman and about Prophet Yusuf and about Imam Ali and about the Quran. Ali al-Hadi, how old is he? Still, before he even reaches 12, 13 years old, young. Don't ever let anyone make you doubt your imams. Your imams' knowledge is miles ahead of anyone who surrounded them. Have pride When you say Ali al-Hadi, if it's the wilada of Imam al-Hadi or the shahada of Imam al-Hadi, don't let anyone tell you this is a small shahada. Don't let the mosques be empty. These are the beacons of knowledge from Ahlulbayt. Come and honor their knowledge. Yahya looks at him, he says, first question I want to ask you is about Prophet Adam, the tree that he ate from. What was it originally known as? He said it was originally known as the tree of envy. He said, yes, you are right. Mu'tasim, are you happy? He said, no, ask him another question. That was too easy. He said to him, Prophet Sulaiman said, who can bring me the Queen of Sheba's throne? And the Queen of Sheba's throne was in one part of the world. Prophet Sulaiman said, I want it in front of me now. So Prophet Sulaiman, one of the jinn said, I can bring it. And then Asif bin Barkhiya said, I'll bring it without the blinking of the eye. And the throne came straight away. He said, Prophet Sulaiman, oh Ali al-Hadi, could not have done it himself. Why does he need to ask? Ali al-Hadi looked at him and he said, oh no, he could do it himself. But he wanted to make clear to the people who is the successor after he dies. Mu'tasim said, ask again. He said to him, in sujood, prostration, aren't we only meant to do sujood to Allah? Ali al-Hadi said, why? He said, how comes Ya'qub does sujood to Yusuf in the Quran? Imam Ali al-Hadi looked at him and he said, in sujood we have two types of prostrations in Islam. We have a prostration for Allah and a prostration which is obedience to Allah. He said to him, what do you mean? He said, when Allah asked the angels to prostrate to Adam, can we prostrate to Adam? Can we prostrate to a human? No. But it wasn't the prostration of worship, it was the prostration of obedience. Likewise, when Yusuf Ya'qub did prostration to him, it wasn't the prostration of worship, it was the prostration of obedience. He said to him, thank you. He said, let me ask you another question. Ali ibn Abi Talib, when people fought him at Jamal, he let them escape after the battle. But those at Safin, he never let them escape. Why? He said those who were... Now this, imagine, I want you to imagine this. That this is a young man. And he's talking about something that happened 250 years before him, for example. Or 200 years. Or whatever the date is. 180. You find that he said to him, Imam Ali, let the people of Jamal escape. Because those people, once the war had finished, were not intent on instigating a further fight. They surrendered. And the narrations within the Quran say, bring peace between the people. Whereas those at Safin wanted to continue fighting. And however many times they were given a chance, they would pick up a weapon again and come back and fight. Those at Jamal, by the time Jamal finished, were still believers. Whereas those in Safin had become infidels. He said to him, okay. Ask me a question about Surah 31 verse 27. Mu'tasim looked at Yahya. He said, if he answers this question, that will be enough for me. I'll let the man go. So he said to him, in Surah 31 verse 27, it says, if all the trees were pens, and the seas, and the seven seas were all ink, they would not be able to exhaust the words of Allah. Name me the seas and name me the words. Mu'tasim looked and he said, if he can answer this, I will let him go. Imam al-Hadi, only 7-8 years old, looks at Mu'tasim and he looks at Yahya bin Akhtam. He says, the seven seas is the sea in Yemen, and the sea of Tabariya, and the sea of Kibrit, and the sea of Bahran, and the sea of Barhut, and the sea of Lisan, and the sea of Ceylan. He said to him, okay, and what are the words of Allah? He said, the words of Allah are as'al Muhammad, that if you got all the trees and they were pens, and that you got seven seas and they were ink, all of them, if they came together, would not be able to exhaust the virtues of Muhammad and al-Muhammad. He looked at him. He said, you've answered my question now. I will let you go. Mu'tasim, when he was Khalifa after this incident, said to Imam Ali al-Hadi, he said, very well, you could teach in Medina. After Mu'tasim died, Wathiq became the Khalifa. in that period, Imam Ali al-Hadi, they allowed him to teach. There wasn't much oppression for the Imam. Where would he teach? He'd teach in the Prophet's mosque in Medina. Imam Ali al-Hadi would have lessons in the Prophet's mosque in Medina on a couple of areas. The first of them, he would have a lesson on the Sahifa of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Someone says, what do you mean Sahifa of Ali ibn Abi Talib? What's that? Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib would sit under Rasulullah. Rasulullah would give lessons, Imam Ali would write the lesson. Imam Ali kept the lessons. You know when you go to university, you write lecture notes? Imam Ali kept all Rasulullah's lecture notes. He then gave them to Imam Hassan, to Imam al-Hussein, to Imam Zain al-Abidin, until they reached Imam al-Hadi. Imam al-Hadi would have the Sahifa of Imam Ali. He'd sit in the mosque of Rasulullah and he would say, Ali ibn Abi Talib heard Rasulullah say, for example, one of the hadiths he had a lecture on was that faith is in the heart and it is supported by your deeds and they are unified by your tongue. Faith is where? In the heart. But the heart is not enough. Sometimes you get Muslims who say, Sayyid Ammar, our heart is good. Isn't that enough? Honestly, I remember someone once saying that my heart is good, but I don't pray and I don't fast. What will happen to me on the day of judgment? Allah will take your heart and he'll put it in Jannah, and the rest he'll put in Jahannam. I said, what's the point of just having a good heart? What's the point? Yeah, Allah will say, heart, come here, go to Jannah. The idea is that the heart is where faith is. And it's supported with action. There's no point in my heart, I love Hussein, but my behavior is exactly the opposite of Hussein. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Those who believe and do good deeds. Not just those who believe. In the Muslim world today, we have so many who believe, but there's no good deeds. Imam says in the Sahifa of Imam Ali, and this Sahifa is with Imam al-Zaman right now, the original words of Rasulullah, which were transmitted through Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib when he would take lessons from Rasulullah. Because you know, didn't Rasulullah say, I am the city of knowledge and Ali is its gate? You found the Imam would give lessons, number one, on this issue. Number two, then the Imam, after Imam Zain al-Abidin, no Imam of the Imams of Al-Muhammad has left us as many du'as as Imam Ali al-Hadi alayhi salam. People would say he's the second Zain al-Abidin. Imam Ali al-Hadi, in my own research, maybe ulama who are of greater knowledge than I am will find more. In my own research, I found 43 du'as of Imam Ali al-Hadi. And Imam Zain al-Abidin, 51. 43 du'as of Imam Ali al-Hadi. And do you know what most of Imam Ali al-Hadi's du'as focus on? The whispering of shaitan, Ya Allah, do not let it affect me. Because many times, any trouble you see in community or at home, it's always because of the whispers of shaitan, isn't it? Imam Ali al-Hadi, many times his du'as would focus on the whispering of shaitan. He'd sit and his students would sit in front of him in the mosque in Medina, and Imam al-Hadi would say to them, listen to the following du'a, du'a, du'a. There is even now, alhamdulillah, a website called du'as.org. On that website, go to Imam al-Hadi's du'as, the most beautiful du'as after Imam Zain al-Abidin, Imam Ali al-Hadi's du'as. And arguably after that, after teaching du'a, he taught them a ziyarah, which after ziyarat Ashura is arguably the most powerful ziyarah in the religion of Islam, ziyarat al-Jami'ah. Ziyarah al-Jami'ah is the ziyarah of Imam Ali al-Hadi. That ziyarah, many of the scholars say, if you want to understand the meaning of the position of the Imams, read ziyarah al-Jami'ah. Tonight. Everybody try and go on the internet or open up a dua book. Read ziyarah al-Jami'ah of Imam al-Hadi. Look at the power of the words of Imam al-Hadi in that ziyarah. He talks about the role of the Imam, the position of the Imam, the meaning of the Imams of Al-Muhammad in Ziyarat al-Jami'ah. In other words, in the time of Mu'tasim, then Wathiq, Imam al-Hadi had a relatively peaceful time. But then after they died, he had to face one of the worst khulafa in Islamic history, Al-Mutawakkil. Do you know Al-Mutawakkil 47 times tried to destroy the grave of Imam Al-Hussein in Karbala? How many times? 47 times Al-Mutawakkil tried to destroy the grave of Imam Al-Hussein in Karbala. 47. In other words, virtually every month in his time as Khalifa, Al-Mutawakkil would try and cause the destruction of the grave of Abu Abdullah. And I tell you, were it not for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that grave would not be there today. Al-Mutawakkil, when he became Khalifa, Al-Mutawakkil was where? The narrations mention that later on he would be in Samarra. Imam al-Hadi was where? In Medina. Al-Mutawakkil knew that this Ali al-Hadi, Mu'tasim and Wathiq, gave him an easy ride. If I give him an easy ride, then this person will end up taking the masses. And then number two, Al-Mutawakkil knew the Mahdi would be coming very soon. And Al-Mutawakkil knew the Mahdi would be from the line of Fatima. And that Ali al-Hadi is from the line of Fatima. So Al-Mutawakkil told his advisor Yahya bin Hardama. He said, Yahya, I want you to go to Medina. Please listen to this story. I want you to go to Medina with 300 of your soldiers. I tell you, brothers and sisters, no Khalifa put an Imam under house arrest like Al-Mutawakkil. From this day onwards, Imam Ali al-Hadi was under house arrest. Can you imagine from your youth, they take you under house arrest. Al-Mutawakkil, what did he do? Al-Mutawakkil told Yahya bin Harthama, Yahya, take 300 soldiers, go to Medina. Yahya said, why? He said, in Medina, Ali ibn Muhammad al-Hadi lives there. I do not want him to stay there. Tell him we are in Samarra. He has to come and live in Samarra. Do you know why the Abbasids were living in Samarra? The Abbasids were worried about the Turks. The Turks were now more powerful than the Abbasids. Abbasids, Samarra is where? Samarra is north Iraq, isn't it? Samarra is towards the north of Iraq. You're going towards, you know, Tikrit and that area. You go north, and that's why Samarra, many say, is dangerous, because you're going in the area which is more dangerous than any other area. They put their capital in Samarra. He said to him, go to Ali al-Hadi with 300 soldiers, and I want you to get Ali al-Hadi, and you bring him to Samarra, and he has to leave Medina and come and live here. Yahya bin Harthama says, at the time, I didn't really believe Ali al-Hadi was an Imam who is worth following. He said, on our way to Medina, I had a soldier who was from the Khawarij. You know, the people who hate Imam Ali. And I had a soldier from the Shia of Ali al-Hadi. Sometimes you may be a soldier, but you're working for the government still. He said, on our way to Medina, these two had a debate. The Kharijite looked at the Shia and he said, Ali ibn Abi Talib has some hadiths which don't make any sense. How do you follow this man? So the Shia said, which hadith? He said, you have a hadith that Ali ibn Abi Talib says, every earth, every part of the earth will be a grave for a human one day. How can every part of the earth be a grave for a human one day? The Shia said, if Ali ibn Abi Talib says this, Ali ibn Abi Talib must be right. Ali ibn Abi Talib would not say something out of his own. So anyway, they debated this issue in the part of the journey to Medina. He says, we got to Medina, we found where the house of Ali al-Hadi is, and we were ready to tell him, listen, pack up, you've got to go and live in Samarra. We got to the house of Ali al-Hadi. As soon as we got to the house of Ali al-Hadi, what happened? As soon as we got to the house, we entered, we saw people who were knitting, people who were stitching, people who were making saddles, people who were making large coats. I looked at this man and I thought, this is the man they call their Imam? This man doesn't have any common sense whatsoever. Why? Because it was the summer. Iraq in the summer is one of the hottest places on earth, isn't it? He said, Ali al-Hadi is asking people to do what? He is asking people to knit in the summer. So So anyway, I told him, Ali, you have to leave. He said, where? He said, Al-Mutawakkil wants you in Samarra. He said, why? He said, Al-Mutawakkil says you have to be under house arrest in Samarra. You are not allowed to practice your life or your teachings freely in Medina. Ali al-Hadi looked at me and said, you see our people who are knitting and stitching? Do you mind? They're going to finish tomorrow and we'll leave on the third day. Yahya said, I said, okay, on the third day we'll leave. I don't know why people are knitting. I don't know why people are stitching. It's hot. What do you need knitwear for? He said, we left on the third day. We're taking the desert back towards Samarra. We reached the place where the Kharijite debated the Shia. When we reached that place, Ali al-Hadi said, keep this knitwear with you. And also the armor, keep it next to you. I said to him, why? He said, just keep it. He said, all of a sudden, we saw from far away a blizzard coming like we had never seen the like of. He said, when this blizzard came, Ali al-Hadi said to us, quickly wear what I gave you. Some of us wore, some of us didn't. The blizzard came. A few minutes later, when the blizzard left us, we got up. He said, I had 300 soldiers at the beginning of the journey. 80 of them had now died. Ali al-Hadi looked at me and he said, Ali ibn Abi Talib was right when he said, every part of the earth will one day be a grave for a human being. He said, I looked at him and I thought, how did he know what we discussed on the way here? Where did he have the knowledge that we were here and we discussed this issue? He said, that's when I believed in the imamate of Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. He said, I took him, we got to Samarra. Brothers and sisters, when you return home tonight, I beg of you one thing. When you return home, please all listen to me. Go down in sujood and thank Allah that you can enter your house without being harassed. When Imam Ali al-Hadi reached Samarra, as soon as he reached Samarra, he went inside his house and he sat down. Now it was the beginning of his house arrest. And Imam Ali al-Hadi entered his house. Mutawakkil did not even come out to meet him. They put him in a small house in Samarra. And I tell you, they may have put him in a small house in Samarra, but the hearts of his followers is where his house is now. You find that they put him in that house, small house in Samarra. Do you know what the narration say? Mutawakkil said, let the man stay in that house. He will not leave his house without us watching his every move. A couple of days later, Mutawakkil fell ill. When he fell ill, he had eaten something which had been poisoned. Someone came to the house of Imam al-Hadi. Who was it? Mutawakkil's mother. Mutawakkil's mother came to the house of Imam al-Hadi. She said to him, oh Ali ibn Muhammad, I am sorry about the way my son has treated you. Do you mind coming to his house? He's on his deathbed. I beg of you, look after him. Say something. Tell us what we shall do. An Imam of Al-Muhammad could have easily been someone who turned around and say, no, your son is a man who has hurt me. But Al-Muhammad, their hearts are the hearts of generosity. He said to our mother of Mutawakkil, let him eat a part of lamb and let him also have some rose water. And inshallah, God willing, he will be cured. She went back. She sat next to her son. Her son who tried to destroy the grave of Imam al-Hadi's grandfather 47 times. She gave him a part of the lamb. He ate it. She gave him some rose water to drink. Mutawakkil had made a nether, a vow, that if I survive this, I will give mal kathir, a great amount of wealth. He managed to survive. His mother secretly came back to Imam al-Hadi. She said to him, I thank you very much. My son has survived. Here is 10,000 dinar in a bag. Someone was watching her come to Imam al-Hadi's house. That person was called Abu al-Hasan al-Bathai. This Abu al-Hasan, when he saw her come, he went to al-Mutawakkil. He said, Mutawakkil, Ali al-Hadi, I think, is trying to raise people against you. Mutawakkil said, how? He said, I saw your mother go to his house and she gave him a bag. Al-Mutawakkil said, very well. This Ali al-Hadi is of no good to us. Mutawakkil doesn't know, if it wasn't for his advice, he wouldn't be alive. He said, this Ali al-Hadi is of no good to us. At midnight or in the middle of the night, send Sa'id in the middle of his house. I don't care if his family is awake or he's asleep, wake him up and find out what he has in his house. Sa'id narrates, wallah, I went to the house of Imam al-Hadi in the middle of the night. Brothers and sisters, tonight when you sleep, 10 hours in the night, 8 hours, 6 hours, you know nobody's gonna walk in and wake you up. Sa'id narrates, I walked into the house, all of a sudden I heard a voice, Sa'id, wait, I'll give you a candle. It was Imam al-Hadi telling him. Imam al-Hadi got up, he said, Sa'id, what is it? He said, Ali, we need to search your house because we think you are getting money to fight us. What is this 10,000? He said, it's the bag from Mutawakkil's mother. Mutawakkil was dying. I told her what Mutawakkil should eat. What is this? He said, it's a mattress. What's that? It's a jug. What's that? A prayer mat. He said, you have nothing else in this house? He said, I swear I have nothing else. This is all we live on. He said, very well, I still do not accept this. Come with me outside the house. We're going to walk to the king's palace. They had to walk in the middle of the night, Imam al-Hadi. Imam al-Hadi reached there. Mutawakkil looked at him. He said to him, what's happening? He said, are you trying to mobilize? Imam al-Hadi said, why don't you ask your friend? Sa'id, what does he have in his house? He said, he has a bag, 10,000 dinar. He said, what's that 10,000? He said, your mother gave it to me. Why did my mother give you 10,000 dinar? Because when you were dying and you were being poisoned, it was me who told your mother what you should eat, and that's why you're alive now. He said to him, forgive me, let the man walk back in the house. Do you know they would do this to him every week? Every week in the middle of the night, they enter his house and pull him out. Why? To try and hurt him. Every week in the middle of the night, they open the door, Imam al-Hadi. Get out. What have I done wrong? What is it? What am I doing? You tell me. Am I doing something wrong? No. The king wants to see you. Gets to the house of the king. The king looks at him. One time they brought Imam al-Hadi and Mutawakkil was drinking alcohol. And he told Imam al-Hadi, why don't you have a drink of this as well? And Imam al-Hadi looked at him. He said to him, I don't want any drink of this. Mutawakkil looked at him. He said, Ali ibn Muhammad, recite some poetry for me. Imam said, we are not people of poetry. He said, recite. He said, all I remember is poetry from my father, Amir al-Mu'mineen. And he recited those lines where he told him that there'll be a day. Where are the crowns? Where are the decorations? Where is the glory? At the end, all you'll be will be a human being with worms eating your body under the ground. And they would pull him out and pull him out. Never once would Imam Ali al-Hadi complain about this treatment. Today in our life, one thing goes wrong, we say, Ya Allah, why us? Ali al-Hadi, every week they take him out of his house. And that's why when Mutawakkil, when he made the vow, if I become well, then I will give mal kathir. When Mutawakkil became well, Mutawakkil said, I wonder, I said mal kathir. Kathir means a lot. How much should I give? So they went to one of the guards of Mutawakkil. How much? He said, 1,000 dinar. They went to one of the ulama. How much is kathir? 100,000 dinar. He said, no. None of you are right. Get me Ali al-Hadi. I want to see what he thinks. They pull Imam al-Hadi out of his house in the middle of the night. They wouldn't do it in the morning. No, we won't let him sleep in the night. I tell you, these imams, what did they go through in their life? Honestly, what did they go through? Imagine every week a man comes to wake you up, get out. Mutawakkil said, sitting, he said, I made a vow. Imam al-Hadi said, what was it? He said, I made a vow, if I became well, I would give mal kathir. Mal is money, kathir is a lot. But now I don't know what a lot is. What is kathir? Imam said, 83 dinar you should give. He said, sorry? He said, 83 dinar. He said, 83. He said, yes, only 83. He said, why? He said, because of the verse in the Quran. He said, which verse? He said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wa laqad nasarakum Allah fi mawatin kathira. Allah has given you victory in mawatin kathira. He said, you want the word kathir in the Quran? This is the verse where the word kathir is used. He said, well, what does the verse mean? He said, Allah gave the Prophet 83 victories in his life. Therefore, you should pay 83 dinar on this issue. Mutawakkil looked at him. He then said, only you people have knowledge like this. He let him go. He take him back. On another occasion, in the middle of the night, Imam al-Hadi is asleep. The children are asleep. They enter the house. They ransack the house. Everyone wake up, wake up. These grandchildren of Fatima to Zahra would not get a week of sleep, which was proper. Wake up! Where is Ali al-Hadi? And Imam Ali al-Hadi would get up. What is it? Come to the castle of Mutawakkil. I'm sleeping. Can't I have just some sleep? No? Get up. He gets to Mutawakkil's castle. There is a Christian man standing there. Ali ibn Muhammad. This Christian man committed zina with a Muslim woman, adultery. I have asked that alim Yahya bin Aktham. He said, you know Yahya bin Aktham? He said, of course we know Yahya bin Aktham. He said, I asked Yahya bin Aktham, this Christian man has committed zina with a Muslim. And we're about to punish him, but the Christian man has now read his shahada. So he said that Yahya bin Aktham says the Christian man should be forgiven. Because when you read your shahada, all before is forgiven. And this alim says, no, he should be whipped. What's your opinion? You see, Imam al-Hadi could have easily turned around and say, you ask me in the middle of the night for an opinion. You can't wait till the morning. But this is how they treat Imam al-Hadi. Imam al-Hadi said, no, the person has to be whipped until he dies. He said to him, why? He said, the verse in the Quran, when they see our punishment, that is when they say we believe in Allah. He said, it's easy for a person who commits zina that when you are about to give him the punishment, that he now says, I become a Muslim. No. There is a verse which says, when they see our punishment, that's when they say we believe. He said, very well. And the punishment was meted out. Week after week, Imam al-Hadi would go through this. And that's why his Shia found it difficult to reach him. At the beginning, his Shia would just about meet him outside his house. Yunus Naqash, Isa, others of his followers would say, we just about meet him. Yunus Naqash narrates, I came to Imam al-Hadi secretly one day. I said, Imam, save my life. Imam said, Yunus, what is it? He said, one of the Abbasids has told me to engrave something on a gem. On a gemstone. I was meant to engrave something. Imam, while I was engraving, the gemstone fell and broke into half. Imam said to him, Yunus, do not worry. Tomorrow you will receive good news. He said, Imam, what do you mean? This Abbasid Khalifa, I have broken the gem of his daughter. You think he's going to forgive me? He's going to kill me. Imam said, do not worry. Tomorrow you'll wake up, you'll receive good news. Yunus left. He said, Imam al-Hadi has told me this, but surely this Abbasids are going to kill me. He said, the next day, the Abbasid Khalifa called me. He said, where is the gemstone? He said, now I know I'm going to die. He said, I looked at him and I said, what do you mean? He said, can you do me a favor? He said, what is it? He said, my two daughters have had an argument about the gemstone. Can you split it in half? Allah. Sometimes you need a leader whose connection is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You find that he came back to the Imam. He said, oh Imam, he said that his daughters had an argument and he wanted it cut in half. And I looked at him and I said, I'll think about it. He said, he doesn't know inside, I virtually had a heart attack and died. But I said, I'll think about it, and I've now designed it my own way. Another man by the name of Isa, he said, we used to never get access to Imam al-Hadi. The moment we'd get any access to Imam al-Hadi, what would happen? He said, I saw in my dream Rasulullah one day. Rasulullah gave me 30 dates. When I woke up, I thought to myself, those 30 dates, it must mean that I'm going to live for 30 years. He said, I was walking. I saw Ali al-Hadi sitting on the ground. He was giving out dates. Then he gave me 30 dates. I looked at him and I said, oh Imam al-Hadi, why don't you give me more dates? He looked at me and he said, if my grandfather Rasulullah had given you more, I would have given you more as well. Subhanallah. And that's why Mutawakkil one day was in trouble. Mutawakkil one day A case was brought to him, which he made Imam al-Hadi wake up in the middle of the night to answer. A lady came, Mutawakkil, they caught her, they brought her to Mutawakkil. Mutawakkil said, "Who's this lady?" They said to him, "Zainab." He said, "Which Zainab?" He said, "Zainab, daughter of Ali ibn Abi Talib." Mutawakkil said, "Sorry?" He said, "Zainab, daughter of Ali." He said, "Which Ali?" He said, "Ali ibn Abi Talib." He said, "What do you mean Ali ibn Abi Talib? Ali ibn Talib died 200 years ago. And Zainab died after him." He said to the lady, "Lady, explain yourself." She looked at him and she said, "Yes, I am Zainab, daughter of Ali, sister of Hussein." Mutawakkil said, "Listen, I drink a lot. But today I haven't drunk. I'm in my senses today. And I'm looking at you and I know I'm not drunk. How are you Zainab, daughter of Ali? How?" She said, "Because every night in my dream, Rasulullah touches me, so I get my youth back." Mutawakkil looked and he said, "This is confusing. Go wake him up. Go to Imam al-Hadi's house that night." Imam al-Hadi sound asleep after having done his Salat al-Layl, having done his Fajr, wake him up. Come out, Imam al-Hadi. Imam al-Hadi comes, Mutawakkil looks at him. He says, "Ali, we have an issue." "So what is it?" He said, "This lady, and I'm not drunk, this lady says she is Zainab, daughter of Ali." Imam al-Hadi looked at her and said, which Ali?" She said, "Ali, son of Abu Talib." He said, "You mean my great-grandfather. And you're who, sorry?" "Oh, I'm Zainab." "Which Zainab?" "Zainab, daughter of Ali, sister of Hussein." "You mean Hussein, my great-grandfather, and Zainab, you're meant to be my auntie, Zainab, from Karbala." Said, "Yes, that's me." Said, "So how'd you get your youth back?" She said, "Oh, every night I see your grandfather, Rasulullah, he touches me on my shoulder, I get my youth back." He said to her, "Very well." Mutawakkil said, "How are we going to resolve this?" Imam al-Hadi said, "Simple. Mutawakkil, you still have your lions in a cage?" Mutawakkil used to keep lions in his cage. So Mutawakkil said, "Yes, my lions are there. They are sitting and they're happy." He said, "If she is truly Zainab, daughter of Ali, let her enter a cage of lions. I tell you, none of the lions will come near her." You know what she did? She said, "Well, if you're Ali and you're truly the grandson of Muhammad, then you go in a cage of lions." She turned it around on him. Imam al-Hadi said, "Very well, Mutawakkil, allow me to enter the cage of your lions." He opens the cage of lions. Imam al-Hadi goes and sits in there. The hadith narrated in our books and the books of our brothers and other schools of Islam says, when Imam al-Hadi sat in the cage, every lion came and sat next to Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. He then turned around to her and he said, "Now are you Zainab?" She said, no, I promise I'm not Zainab anymore. I'm not going in." And she walked away. You found therefore Imam al-Hadi was harassed constantly. And that's why Imam al-Hadi, because his Shia could not come to him, the first email system of Shia to their leader began with Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. Someone says, "Said Ammar, email wasn't there at that time." No, I don't mean email. I mean that the Shia from that time, because there was no access to their Imam, that's when letters began to Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. There is a book available in the Tabligh library, the biography of Imam al-Hadi. In it, there's a whole chapter about all the fiqh masail, all the jurisprudence masail, all the law legal issues which were written as letters to Imam al-Hadi and Imam al-Hadi's answers. Because today someone says, Sayyid al-Sistani, may Allah lengthen his life, Sayyid Ali Khamenei, may Allah lengthen his life. People say, how do these people answer questions? How? Where do they get their knowledge from? Do you know a lot of their knowledge comes from Imam Ali al-Hadi? Someone says, what do you mean? Imam al-Hadi, because the Shia could not get access to him because he was under house arrest, many of them would write fiqh letters to Imam al-Hadi. Those fiqh letters were preserved by Imam al-Askari. And they continued with all the ulama of al-Muhammad. Those fiqh letters remain with us until today. And the great companions of Imam al-Hadi would make sure those letters would reach people like Shah Abdul Azim al-Hasani. Have you been to Shah Abdul Azim? How many of you have been to Bahrain to visit Shah Abdul Azim? Companion of Imam al-Jawad and Imam al-Hadi. People like Ali bin Mahziyar, companion of Imam. People like Ahmed bin Muhammad bin Isa. People like Ayyub bin Nuh. People of that caliber, that particular generation of renowned scholars, Hassan bin Rashad. These people would make sure the letters would reach the Imam. And until today, those letters are preserved. And until today, if you study to become a mujtahid, you need to study the letters of Imam al-Hadi and his answers to those questions. Go and study them. Many of our fiqh masail come from Imam al-Baqir, Imam al-Sadiq, and Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. For example, they wrote him a letter, "Oh Imam, when we do ghusl of a body and the murji'ah are present," the murji'ah are a sect of Islam who used to say, "What is important is not your actions, it is your heart." So if today I'm drinking alcohol, doesn't matter, my heart is good, the alcohol, no problem. No murji'ah. The Shia wrote a letter to Imam al-Hadi. There was no access for the Shia, and this was the beginning now. Imam al-Askari tomorrow, Imam Zaman the day after. Now is the beginning of the Shia getting used to a lack of relation with their Imam, but with letters they would reach him. "Oh Imam, can we do ghusl? Can a murji'ah be in our presence when we are doing ghusl? Do we have to do it in the way of the murji'ah or the way which you, the imams, have taught us?" The murji'ah, for example, wouldn't use the palm branch. You know how we use the palm branch and so on? They wouldn't use. Imam said, "No, do it in our way, but try to secretly put the palm branch without them seeing." Another letter, "Oh Imam, I am a Shia who lives far away from you. I live in an area where I know it is haram, it is forbidden for me to wear a belt which is made from the leather or from the fur of an animal who it is haram to eat, or from an area where it is haram because of the slaughter. Oh Imam, but the problem is all the animals here are slaughtered in the haram way. Oh Imam, is there any animal which we are allowed to use the fur of in this situation?" The Imam replied, "The beaver is an animal you are allowed to use the fur of in the situation you are living in." Another letter says, "Oh Imam, if someone walks past me in salah in my area, is my salah invalid or does my salah remain?" Imam says, "Your salah does not become invalid by someone walking past you." Another letter, "Oh Imam, my wife is breastfeeding in the month of Ramadan. Does she have to fast?" Imam would reply, "Your wife is not obliged if she is breastfeeding. She is not obliged to fast in the holy month of Ramadan." Thousands of letters would be written to Imam al-Hadi, which are preserved until today on the Masail of Fiqh. And that's why when Mutawakkil, you know who killed Mutawakkil? Mutawakkil was killed by his son Muntasir. You know why? Muntasir saw Mutawakkil hurt Imam al-Hadi, and then Muntasir saw Mutawakkil. Do you know what Mutawakkil began? He began a comedy stage show where he would get an effeminate man. I don't need to use other language. You know what I mean by effeminate man? Who would play Ali ibn Abi Talib. The man would put a cushion under his dress and he would make himself look bold and he'd say, "I am Ali ibn Abi Talib." Muntasir came and he despised the way his dad behaved. He said to Imam al-Hadi, "What do you think will happen? Or what is the ruling on someone who curses Fatima al-Zahra and Ali ibn Abi Talib?" Imam said, "That person is to be killed. It is not allowed in Islam." He said, "And what happens if that is someone's father?" Imam said to him, "That will be the end of his son's life. His son will die shortly afterwards because he has broken Salat al-Rahim." Muntasir said, "While I'm alive, my father will not do this." Muntasir went and killed his own father, Mutawakkil. 6 months later, Muntasir himself died. One Khalifa after another died until Mu'taz came into power. When Mu'taz found out Imam al-Hadi had that much following, Mu'taz decided, "I will do what Mutawakkil didn't do, what Muntasir didn't do, what Mu'tasim didn't do, what Wathiq didn't do, what Musta'in didn't do. I will put poison in the food of Imam Ali al-Hadi. And you know, Imam Ali al-Hadi, while he was dying, he would ask his companions, he'd say to them, do me one favor, the poison has affected my body. He would write to them and he'd say, I beg of you, go to one grave. They would say to him, where? He'd say to them, go to the grave in Karbala. Go near that holy man who lies in the ground in Karbala. They would write back by saying to him, oh Imam, but that man, aren't you his grandson? Don't you have the same effect with Allah? He said, nobody has a role or relationship like my grandfather Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. And that's why he would echo the words of Imam al-Sadiq, when Imam al-Sadiq and the ziyarah of Imam al-Hussein would say, oh Allah, have mercy on those cheeks that rub themselves on the grave of Imam al-Hussein. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to raise us with Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. Allow us to be amongst those who follow his message in this world and the hereafter. Inshallah, tomorrow we will continue with the life of Imam al-Askari, to be followed by the life of Imam al-Hujja, ajjalallah farajahu al-Sharif, and then to be concluded with the life of Imam al-Hasan on his wilada. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those who are ill in the world, in the name of the one ill in Karbala, Imam Zain al-Abidin. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Amman yujibu al-Muthtar idha da'ah wa yakshifu al-su' amman yujibu al-Muthtar إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. Raise your hands. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the Surah Al-Fatiha, but before it, the loudest of your salawat. Allahumma salli.